A recurring theme in science and mathematics is to find the fundamental building blocks of something, then study the different ways you can put them together. For example, in chemistry, the building blocks of everyday matter are atoms. And there are different types of bonds, which describe how they can be stuck together to make molecules. In number theory, you learn that the building blocks of integers are prime numbers, and that every positive whole number has a unique factorization into primes. In group theory, the fundamental building blocks of finite groups are called simple groups, and there are many ways you can piece them together to make larger, more complex groups. One way is the direct product. Suppose you have any two groups, G1 and G2. These two groups can be finite or infinite, abelian or non-abelian. The direct product is a way to combine these two groups into a new, larger group. It's the set of all pairs where the first component is from G1 and the second component is from G2. The notation for the direct product is the same as a Cartesian product of two sets. The group operation is performed component-wise. Let AB and XY be two elements in the direct product G1 times G2. Then, their product is defined to be the pair AX and BY. You just multiply the first components, then multiply the second components. The identity element in this group is E1, E2, where E1 is the identity element in G1, and E2 is the identity element in G2. Let's see an example. Let G1 be the group of integers under addition, and G2 be the group 1, negative 1, I, and negative I under multiplication. The direct product of G1 and G2 is a set of all pairs where the first component is an integer, and the second component is one of the four numbers in G2. Let's pick two random elements from the direct product. How about 7, negative 1, and negative 3i? If you wanted to, you could use a new symbol for the direct product group operation, like an asterisk. But we'll keep things simple and use multiplicative notation for the direct product. To combine these two pairs, we add the first components and multiply the second components. This is because the group operation for G1 is addition, and the operation for G2 is multiplication. Doing this gives us 4, negative I. The identity element in this group is 0, 1. For example, if you combine 5, negative I, and 0, 1, you add the first components to get 5, and you multiply the second components to get negative I. So the product of 5, negative I, and 0, 1 is 5, negative I. We can check that this works for any element. If XY is an element in the direct product, then XY times 0, 1 is X plus 0, Y times 1, which equals XY. So 0, 1 is an identity element. It's good practice to verify that the other group requirements are met. For example, what's the inverse of 12, negative I in this group? Does every element have an inverse? And does the associative property hold? You can take the direct product of more than two groups. For example, the direct product of G1, G2, and G3 is a set of all triples, where the first component is from G1, the second component is from G2, and the third component is from G3. Like before, the group operation is performed component-wise. The product of A, B, C, and X, Y, Z is AX, BY, and CZ. The identity element is E1, E2, E3, where E1 is the identity element in G1, E2 is the identity in G2, and E3 is the identity in G3. And there's no reason to stop with three groups. You can take the direct product of 4, 5, or any number of groups. You can even take the direct product of an infinite number of groups. As another example, let's take the direct product of the integers mod 3 under addition, the integers mod 5 under addition, and the integers mod 6 under addition. The elements in this direct product are triples, with the first component from G1, the second component from G2, and the third component from G3. The first group has 3 elements, the second group has 5 elements, and the third group has 6 elements. So the order of the direct product is 3 times 5 times 6, which is 90. Since all three groups use additive notation, we'll use additive notation for the direct product too. The sum of 1, 3, 4 and 2, 1, 3 is 0, 4, 1. This is because 1 plus 2 is 0 mod 3, 3 plus 1 is 4 mod 5, and 4 plus 3 is 1 mod 6. The identity element in this group is 0, 0, 0. Here's a question for you. What's the inverse of 1, 3, 2 in this group? We've now seen two examples of direct products, the integers with a finite group and the direct product of three finite groups. It's worth pointing out that if you take the direct product of a bunch of groups, then if any one of the groups is infinite, the direct product will be infinite too. But what if all the groups are finite? In this case, it depends. If you take the direct product of a finite number of finite groups, then you end up with another finite group. In this case, the order of the direct product is a product of the sizes of the individual groups. However, if you take the direct product of an infinite number of finite groups, then you'll end up with an infinite group. Up to now, all the groups we've considered have been abelian. Let's now look at a direct product where one of the groups is non-abelian. For this example, we'll look at the direct product of the real numbers under addition and the symmetric group S3. While the real numbers are an abelian group, S3 is a non-abelian group. For example, let's use cycle notation and look at the permutations A equals 2, 3 and B equals 1, 2. A times B equals 1, 3, 2, while B times A equals 1, 2, 3. So A times B does not equal B times A. This carries over to the direct product. For example, if we combine 1a and 2.5b, you get 3.5 and the cycle 1, 3, 2. But if you reverse it and compute the product of 2.5b and 1a, you get 3.5 and the cycle 1, 2, 3. So the direct product is not an abelian group. This example highlights another important point. If you take the direct product of several groups, and if any one of the groups is not abelian, then the direct product is non-abelian too. Here's why. Suppose we have a direct product, and we arrange the groups so that G1 is a non-abelian group. This means there are elements AB in G1, where A times B does not equal B times A. Let's now use this to show the direct product is non-abelian. Look at the elements X equals A, E2, E3, etc., and Y equals B, E2, E3, etc. So the first components are A and B, while the other components are the identity elements in their corresponding groups. X times Y is AB, E2, E3, etc. And Y times X equals BA, E2, E3, etc. And since AB does not equal BA, these two values are different. So the direct product is not commutative. If all the groups are abelian, however, then the direct product will also be abelian. You'll use this fact when proving the fundamental theorem of finitely generated abelian groups. In short, this says that any abelian group that is finitely generated is a direct product of the integers or the integers mod n for various n. The direct product is a useful tool for breaking some groups into simpler groups. Notice I said some groups, not all groups. This is because there are many groups which are not direct products of simpler groups. It would be great if groups were that simple, but they're not. Luckily, there are other tools for deconstructing groups, and we'll cover those in separate videos. At Socratica, the rate at which we make videos is the direct product of views, subscribers, and Patreon supporters. If you'd like to help us make videos more quickly, please consider sharing our videos with someone, subscribing to our channel, or if you're feeling particularly generous, supporting us on Patreon. Our patrons are part of a small but very important finite group. Thank you.